Yeah, so loading plan for containers, very important. This topic, we are going to do it now. The part is today. Then as if we've left it, then we'll come at it again at the very last end of our engagement here. You see, loading plan of containers, they are just trying to tell you how containers should be stored properly, how you optimize the volume, how you optimize the space given to you, how you average the highest permissible weight, tons. So for instance, as I was saying the previous day, we have the light and the heavy, we have the light or dry, or we have the heavy or the dense or the wet cargoes. The wet, dense, the wet, dense or heavy cargoes are those items that are very heavy by nature, so that the least minimum amount you start storing in the container gives you, you optimize the maximum weight permissible. You cannot go big, more than the maximum weight to play. But light, dry cargoes are those which are very light. They don't have any weight, but they can easily fill the container, optimize all the volume. Meanwhile, the container will be very light. And I was giving you an example like that. If you bring cargo from Gambia, our brothers who have imported cargo, the one we enjoy so much, cargo's weight is a dry air, dries a certain fish that have been drying. They dry it to the extent that all the wetness have been dried and squeezed out of it. So it's very light. So a 40-foot cargo load will only weigh about 1,000 something. It does not weigh 2,000. You get it. If you put wool into a container, very light. So you can, the whole volume will be filled, and the wood, and the weight can be about 500 or 800 kilos. That's it. But you just put a small piece of lead metal, you are bringing for factory for melting, metals, they are only here because they have to be stacked the same way that the container on this when the ship is moving. So they are only here, so all this space free. So those mass importers will find some very light weight cargoes and stuff it. If not, if you don't want the cargo to move without what we call lashing, the containers are also lashed on the vessels as explained. But lashing takes place in the container too. If not, this cargo will be shifting. Will be shifting, so they are lashed. And that, any other way that they are made fixed, and lashing is, they will make it fixed on the front of the container so that no matter the impact of the cargo shift, it will not move. The same thing happens if somebody says, I will not put my car in a groupage container. Those consolidations that we do, five cars are stacked in one container, some are hand. But the man says, I'm rich, I've got my money. So my small car, the whole 20 foot, I'll put my car in it. So he buys it. And here the lashing, the way vehicles are lashed, they put wooden chops and they chop the tires, braze it down here firmly. Then some add the metal ropes from top so that the vehicle will never move. But this lashing, if it is not properly done, this cargo shift or cargo movement we are talking about on the high seas is not a very, it is very violent and turbulent. So at times, materials that are used to lash can get torn or disrupted so that the car is moving the container during the voyage. Then if you, the poor agent, poor worker at the port, don't know that the vehicle kept moving on the high seas, and by the time it came to Ghana, it has slided to rest on the door here, okay? It's just resting on the door here, or at times it has moved but was in a good position. But the handling at the port here, when the top lifter and the wrist anchor lifted it, the container tilted, so it went by, then it's put on the ground. Then, hey, master container opener, come and open the container. Everybody is happy. The vehicle runs out amok and can kill you. It happens. We have got those stories in your notes. And it happens. And those people who have been putting bulk cargo in containers without making them break bulk, and the beans of cocoa, rice grains, maize grains. Okay, what they do is that they pump the grains into the container, and those grains are a bit heavy. Okay, they are a bit heavy, so they don't optimize the volume. So space is here, and then the only thing you do is you put a tonnage here. Tonnage is any material to protect it from damage. And if the tonnage here can be also be here, the tonnage are very light materials. But during the voyage, the cargo can shift so much that by the time it's coming to the port, this uniform thing becomes like this. The grain has shifted, and it's lying also resting quietly on the door of the container. Believe me, you, those grains are heavy. And the moment you open the container, they come out with that force and can bury a human being. So these are techniques you employ when you are loading a container. Container loading, as you see, it is not just a light job for any dropout or anybody like you have been. So that is why the loaders are special people abroad. They learn it. There are freight forwarding companies, they cannot pay fully employed loader. So they take on loaders on what? Wages, specific job. When he has got the cargo ready, he employs the loader for a day or two, finishes, wash off his hands, and go and sit down. So the loaders are special people, always on standby, waiting for calls from carriers, freight forwarders that come and load my container for me. And if you watch, mostly when we unstop the container 100% in Ghana, they are not able to put all the packages back. You see them putting the rest of the packages to the driver in their cabinet or tying it at the top of the vessels, the vehicles that they have unstopped. They are not able to unstop because we are not specialists. We are not skillful when it comes to loading. We don't know all these things we are talking about. And these things are not only here, most third world countries. Loaders are considered unskilled labor, but I'm sorry, loaders are skillful. That's the way we handle them along the coast here and this developing world. And a lot of accidents happen. This cargo shift is not an easy thing, it happens always. Yes, so please, if depending on the material that you read on the documents that you've processed and the container is going to be open, I'm begging you, stay some top 50 something meters away. Yes. Clear? Then another loading precaution is, yes. Is it your business to open a container? Haven't you been handling Chinese and those things to the terminal operator? So I'm saying that the terminal operator should know these techniques. You see, the port business, port management is a whole course we learn. Ask him, the student of RMU, tell him, you do port management, what, 1, 2, 3? You see the cargo handling is another. Port management is different. Cargo handling is a course. It's a course on its own. So there they'll be teaching this thing. But the overall port management, that manager, that supervisor, should employ skillful loaders. And they are the same on loaders. Do you get it? So they should be tutored that whenever they see the document, this container contains maybe grains, they should be taken twice. Do you get it? So they should know how to position themselves. The door should be open at any rate. So if they are wise to ensure, to you and me, reasoning question, what should be the physical step they should take that even if finally it's open, that danger will be overcome? What instructions and which type of labourer or port worker should the supervisor concentrate on in this circumstance to avert any accident? You say? Who? Safety officer, correct. But the safety officer is the one calling the manager or the supervisor. You should talk to a certain subordinate who is very critical in this chain. Please. In this chain, it says it's chain command to the last inferior junior officer. who is the immediate critical staff that that safety officer should concentrate on? Yes.
The capital and second or third, the top of the fence. That is either the format that is the supervisor. You have to ensure safety, the right thing done. I'm referring to is your camp. You should talk to the subordinate, please, underneath, directly. And he works closely with that man. Then, because you see, if you know the answer, be confident and talk to me. Don't be swallowing the correct answer. You know the answer, but you're not voicing it out. You see, timidity will kill you. Whatever, then that's it. Yes, I don't hide. I will not offer you to produce timid students. So, I want my students to become better than me. That's my goal. So, tell us, laughing and boldly.
Yes, the machine operated both. The spreader and the top leader.
So you first of all tell them that your machine operator that this container is grace. Here you don't know. You know this kind of PVC base. But to make the proposal, lift it and tilt it in this proposal direction that maybe if the grace have moved, they should go back rather to lean on the other side. So that it will open better. So they should re-handle the container in such a way that if there's any data or the cargo are moved industry, it should be redirected to where the part of the container that they sit. It's about the solution. You see, this thing is thinking. This thing is not really thinking in any way. But you see, when I said, you thought I said, I said, the person who is supposed to be the supervisor is the mature operator that are next to them. Before the fourth driver's car, then now the capital who is the same cutter. The capital was no danger. You know the work of the capital is to cut the seal, to actually unlock the hinges, the door, do it and open it for us. It is the business of the capital. Who does that business with the risk? The gas. So the gas leader is exposed to that leader, not giving a capital. But there are some two local leaders, they want to copy the door. So I'd like them to be.